And if you don't mind standing, as always, out of respect to Jesus. The Word made flesh is Jesus, died on the cross for us. Amen? And we're going to be dealing with a very familiar scripture. I've actually preached on this here before. And we're going to cover it in a different way as the Lord gave it to me, Lord willing. And it is Matthew 6 and 34. And it says this, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for your wonderful blessings. We thank you for a wonderful church family. We just thank you for everything, Lord. You are so mighty and worthy to be praised and glorified. I just can't wait to see you. I can't wait to be in heaven with you. And can't wait to thank you personally for all the great things you've done for us, especially dying on Calvary. In Jesus' name, the church says, Amen. Now, I've got a lot of notes today, so I'm going to have to carry this with me. I'm going to repeat this to you again. "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own thing. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." And if you don't mind, I'm going to read a little bit before this. And so you get the feeling of what Jesus is doing on the Sermon on the Mount. We've been talking about that last week, and we're going to add some more things the Lord has laid on my heart. And in Matthew 6:25 says this, "Therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. If your heavenly Father feeds them, are you not more value than they? Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." Before we can deal with verse 34, which is the main thing of my message, I have to deal with first Matthew 6 and 33. And that it says this, "But seek ye first," Jesus says, "the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Now, first type of person I want to deal with, and I'll get him out of the way, and we're going to go to the rest of the message, is this. People who are not worried. Now, I'm going to cover them first. Now, this message is about you not to worry. But there are certain people that do need to worry. Would you agree? Now, wait, and I'm going to tell you who that person is. These are people who did not worry about eternity. Jesus is telling you, don't worry about your clothing, your food, shelter, stuff like this. But I want to deal with what he says first in 33, and then I'm going to finish the message, is these are a few people I'm going to bring up that didn't worry about eternity. There are certain things that you do need to worry about. And I had this sermon, the Lord dealt with me, he said, I want you to cover that first. So I'm going to cover this first. Cain. Cain was a man that was not worried about eternity. Remember him? He was not worried about it. He did his own thing. How many's ever seen people that didn't worry to their own hurt? You know, you've seen them. They don't think about a thing they're doing. This is what Cain did. So you should be worried, church, about and concerned where you're going to go when you go die. You need to be concerned with that. And that's something you should worry about. Esau, remember Esau wasn't worried about eternity. He sold his birthright for a bowl of porridge. You can't make that up. For a bowl of soup, you exchange eternity. Next person I want to deal with, and I'll be done. Next, I got three more. Saul. Remember Saul? Saul wasn't worried about what God thought. How many's worried about what God thinks of you? I am. I want to know that my Father's proud of me. And so Saul was not worried about what God thought. He would not do one said, he wouldn't do it. No matter how simple it was, he just couldn't do it. He wasn't even high priest one year. This is something really ticked God off. Samuel was the high priest. What does Saul do? Saul says, I'll offer the sacrifice. That's not your job, Saul. You're the king. You're not allowed to do that. Samuel's been consecrated and set apart and been living. You've been out murdering people. You can't offer the sacrifice. So he was an idiot, and he should have been worried about his soul. And then we go to the Pharisees. The Pharisees were so upset, all the religious people, and they're just like that today, I'm sorry. Get mad or glad, but the reality is you know this is true. They think they're so holy. They are so confident, they don't even worry about standing before God. They got everything figured out, got everything worked out. My righteousness I've done throughout my life is so perfect that I am not worried whatsoever. And Jesus said, you're children of the devil. They should have been worried. Should they not have been worried? But they was not worried. You'll meet religious people in your life like this, that they live like Pharisees, think they're better than everybody else, and think they're more holy than everybody else, and really, they're completely out of the will of God. And they're not worried. You seen people like that? I have. Let's move on to the next person that should have been worried, was Judas. Huh? You know, Judas was worried about having praise of men, having praise of the Pharisees. He was worried about all these things that were meaningless and betrayed Christ. And Jesus said it would have been better if that man had never been born. Do you guys remember that? Better had he not been born, because he wasn't worried. So one thing you do want to be worried about is eternity. So be worried about your soul. Now that we've covered that, I can get on with my message. Let's consider here what Jesus is talking about. Verse 34 again says, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own thing. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. And let's look here. He says, in Matthew 6, 19, 20, 21, and 24, I'm going to summarize it for you, then I'm going to read it to you. Do not worry about your bank account. I know nobody's going to like that one. Do not worry again about your bank account. Now, I want you to raise your hands, because I don't want people in here lying today, but everybody in here worries about your bank account. You worry about if you got enough money. Now, if you don't and you're rich, let us know after church and we'll get some from you and we'll stop worrying about it. But you all know everybody worries about your bank account. Very few people ever live a life of simplicity, so they're not worried about having money. We're getting ready to come in the most worrisome time of all of it. And as a matter of fact, I'm to the point I dislike it. And I'm sorry. And that is Christmas. I have not had a Christmas since my first daughter was born where you don't worry about money around this time of year. Now, anybody else besides me? Can I get them what they really need? Can I get them not what they need? You know, the truth is what they really want. And boy, I tell you, the kids can really ask for some big things today. Some of them's already saying, I want an iPhone X. That's only $1,000. Hey, that's easily affordable. No, it's not. It's not affordable at all. But do not worry about your savings account. Now, let's read what Jesus says here. Jesus in 6 and 19 says, do not lay up for yourself treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. So Jesus is telling here, do not worry about your savings account. There was a man that was extremely filthy rich. I'm not mean a little money, I'm talking rich, billionaire. And this guy had so much money that he kept paying the doctors to keep him alive. Well, it come down, they couldn't give him any more transplants. They couldn't give him any more medicine. The man was going to die. And he said this, get ready now, billionaire. He said, I'll give you all the money that I have for 5 more minutes of life. That's how much your savings account is going to be worth when you're dying. You can't take a dime of it with you. That's why I've become confused sometimes with selfish people who hoard their money up and don't help nobody, and you kind of wonder what they're planning on doing with it when they die. Solomon said, I have worked myself to death, laid up all this money to give it to somebody else, and what are they going to do with that money? Well, I can tell you what they did, Solomon. They betrayed God, is what they did with that money. I say unto you, it's better to be born poor than it is to be born with money. I know you wouldn't agree with that, but you're saying, well, why is that true? Because it's easier for a camel to get through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God, and God's people constantly praying for him to give them money. You might really be saying, God, give me something that will separate me from you because I'm tired of depending on you. That's what the children of Israel, we're sick of this manna that comes from heaven. We're sick of how God takes care of us. We're sick of it. And Jesus tells us, do not worry about your savings. You remember Jesus tells another story. And remember this rich guy had all these goods laid up. And what did he do? He took all those goods and says, soul, you've got many goods built up for a long period of time. Build yourself a new barn. And I'd like to have a barn myself. I'm sorry. It's awful. I'd like to have a place to put your junk. It needs more storage. That's because we got too much junk. Junk we don't need. Hasn't made us happy. Are you happier today that you got a phone than when we didn't have phones? No, I'm less happy. Are you happier today that we've got all this other new stuff, more 300 channels of TV, and we're still not happy? I say the best thing you can do is take the TV and throw it out in the trash. And get away from the stuff that it promotes, because it doesn't promote godliness. Yes, I have a TV. But it does not promote godliness. But this foolish man built up barns, laid up all of his treasures, put them in the barn. Oh my. And one day God says, I will call on his soul when he's not expecting me. Because he was rich towards himself, but is not rich towards God. So don't worry about your savings account. It's hard, ain't it? Money has been one thing in my life I have worried the most about. If you've ever owned a business of any kind, I got my family in Kentucky, we're all into trucking. That's all we would talk about. Worried about if you're going to get the right load. Worried about if you're going to get a load. Worried about if the mines are still going to be open. Worried about this. The other families had gas stations or garages and stuff like this. The whole family getting together constantly talking about it. We're going to be able to make it. 20 years, and I've told you this before, there was very few months that I did not worry about money in my shop. Worrying about money. Worrying about money. And you know what it got me? A heart attack. And didn't change a fact. God took care of me the whole time, did he not? There's other than your own businesses. Did you ever worry about money? Yes, you always are worrying about money if you have a small business of any kind. Even if you're a realtor, you're worried about money. How are you going to live till you sell the first house? Isn't that right? You sell insurance the same way. No matter what business you're doing, you're going to worry about money. But Jesus says not to do it. He tells me not to worry, church. I'm not yelling at you. I'm yelling at myself. Do you not know that this? I'm a poster child of somebody who loves to worry. I love to worry. Lord, even if everything in my life is perfect, I'll find something to worry about. I'll find, does anybody else like that besides me? Am I just preaching to myself? I'll find something to worry about. I don't care what it is. I have to worry. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's because Irish or the English or from the South. I don't know what the problem is, but it's worry, worry, worry. I love to worry. Love to. I never get a feeling anymore, boy, you got it made for the day. At least today. No, I don't do that anymore. I'll find something to worry about. Constantly worrying. And if you don't do that, you're a better person than I am. I'm sorry, I'm a worrywart. It's made me sick. A lot of us are ill because we worry so much. Let's face reality. Now, Jesus goes on to say here in Matthew 6:25, therefore I say to you, don't worry about your life. So Jesus tells you, don't even worry about your own life. Don't worry about these things. Now listen to what he says. He says, therefore I say to you, this is Matthew 6:25, do not worry about your life. What you will eat or what you will drink. Not supposed to worry about that. Don't worry about your body. Oh Lord, that's a sermon in itself right there, especially for you poor girls. Constantly worried about your body. Am I skinny? I might be too fat. This is sagging. Something else is falling apart. I have four daughters. Know what I'm talking about. Everybody constantly worried about their physical body. See, first we dealt with men. Stop worrying about your wallet. Of course, women do that now. And now we're going to move on to don't worry about your own life. And now we're going to deal with don't worry about what you're going to eat and what you're going to drink. And now we're getting to your body. We're obsessed with these things. It's almost like that whatever Jesus said to do, we're going to do the opposite. And the world promotes the opposite. Is that not true? You know, you all may not know this. My dad was a photographer for years professionally. And what you may or may not know, as any of you in here should know this, is that's not real, what you're looking at, ladies. It's not real. It's make-believe. They spend hours every... I used to sit at the shop and show people with pictures how I can reduce the size of this, increase the size of that, remove blemishes and all this stuff. You're trying to look like a fantasy. Then you got men who don't know God chasing that fantasy. It does not exist. She's not real. If you marry her, she's still not real. Because they drew a fantasy. But we sure worry about our bodies. Why? Because the world tells you to worry about your bodies. The next thing the world tells you to worry about, Jesus says not to, is what kind of clothes you're going to wear. Why do we worry about these things? God takes care of me. I don't need a suit. I hate suits. I'm totally uncomfortable with that. But you know what the fact is? This is $3. Did God take care of me? Are you seeing what I'm trying to tell you, church? Brother Bruce has been and seen my setup at the house. It's pretty impressive, ain't it? Practically gave to me. You don't have to worry about whether you've got the nicest clothes or not. You don't have to worry about if you've got the best purse or not. You don't have to worry about these things. You don't have to worry about if you got a Cadillac. A Buick's a good car. You don't have to have a Cadillac. You don't have to have a Lincoln. Mercury's a good car. Stop worrying about these things. Don't worry about what you're going to wear. Stop worrying about what you look like. These are the things the church people worry about. We shouldn't be worried about these things. We should not be worried about these things. And then he goes on to say this. Is not life more than food? Is not life more than the body? Is life not more than the clothing that you wear? Is it not worth it? How many have worried for years and years and years and just worried and worried and worried and none of it come to pass? None of it comes to pass. You worry about things that's never going to happen. It's just not going to happen. I notice that worry has taken over every faction of society. Worrying about all kinds of dumb stuff. Dumb stuff. The title bureau is so worried they have bulletproof vests at the title office. What are we going to do? For a car? For what? Is how worried they are. Worried about stupidity. Dumb things. Never happened. Never going to happen. But worry. Worry, worry, worry. And it's promoted on television. You guys know it's promoted on TV. It's promoted everywhere you look. Worry, 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 worry. I got to worry about if some terrorist is going to blow us up. Got to worry about if somebody's going to go to school and shoot the school up. Got to worry about all this stuff. Worrying about this stuff. Is Jesus Christ alive or is he dead? That's what he's asking. Why do you worry about these things?